So how important is it to find the right monologue?
Well, my cousin picked a bad monologue once and died. I mean, it was a couple of years later, but I think it's related.
I'm a giant marmoset.
And I'm 3 2x4s in the shape of Kentucky.
And this is Theater Babble. The most common question that I get asked by students and actors is, how do I find a monologue? I'm always happy to help by giving advice or even suggesting monologues or plays. But to learn how to develop your acting skill and to take the mystery out of finding suitable monologues, we should take a closer look at what that actor is actually trying to communicate. That they don't know what makes a good monologue, they don't know their type,
or that they want you to do the work for them.
Maybe. But it can be challenging to find a good monologue, especially if you don't know what you should be looking for. And to make matters worse, what you should be looking for greatly changes between roles, plays, and directors.
So you're saying it's hopeless and that I should exclusively do Hamlet soliloquies?
No, of course not. There is a foolproof way to find good monologues. Read plays. Read a lot of plays. See, it's not enough to just find a good monologue. It needs to meet other fluctuating criteria as well. The only way to find the right monologue is to have read a multitude of plays that you can then pull from.
But Scott, what are the criteria that factor into a good monologue?
Well, Joren, I'm glad you asked. But before we get into that, today we're filming at the Red Curtain Arts Center in Marysville, Washington. And we're on the set of their production of Something Rotten, which actually happened last summer.
It's been up for a while.
A long while. So, finding a monologue. Joren, what do you do when you're going to go to an audition?
Mm-hmm.
What's kind of your process for looking for a monologue?
Well, the first thing that I generally do is I consider the role that I'm going for. And so that's a huge factor into what you want to sell yourself as, right? So if you're like, I want to be the lead in this play, and therefore I need to kind of present a monologue that shows me in the same kind of acting space as what the lead of the play will be in the play that you're auditioning for. And so if I'm going to look for a monologue, often I'm looking to find other monologues that match, right, the tone of the current monologue. And then from there, I will read plays.
So if you're going to audition for a play, and let's be honest, mm-hmm. because I think I know what the answer is going to be, and our people watching also. How often do you read the play that you're going to audition for before you audition?
Really low. I mean, I will try. I generally have a sense of it. And to be honest, most of the more current roles that I've had, I've been like, Joren, we want you for this role, right? Because you do this thing really well. And so I kind of already have a real clear idea of what the type of role that I'm going for is, right? So if I need to bring an audition, I'll bring something that I kind of know for that role. But yeah, I'm not always like, oh, I need to do a full character analysis of the play that I'm going for. But it certainly doesn't hurt, right? Like if you were really obsessed with getting a specific role, you would want to know what that role is supposed to be like beforehand.
Yeah,
there's at least value in doing that, right? If you were like, I need to be this person in this play, you don't want to go in blind not knowing who that character is. Especially, why do you care if you don't really know?
Right. Why do you want the part if you don't know what the play's about, what the characters are?
I mean, and that idea right there, why do you want the part, is a good factor in finding a good monologue, right? One of the many criteria in evaluating a monologue is, does this fit with why you want the part you're going for? Because at the end of the day, the monologue is you present, your rendition of your monologue in your audition is you presenting yourself as an actor to the director.
Mm-hmm. And the best version of yourself.
Yeah, you're trying to find, you're trying to show them you can, this is you, right? And so if you or when you're looking for a monologue, that's one of the huge criteria you're looking for, is to present yourself and understanding your own why, right? Like why this matters to you, is very illuminating as to what you can do, what you can pull off in a monologue.
Right, which is really good. So that's one of our key criteria for picking out a good monologue, is for you to know your type and understand what that means. We actors in acting, we're so tied up in our ego, and that's not to say that we're all egotistical. About 10% of us aren't, but we're all. Acting is an ego-driven profession or hobby, depending on what level you operate at. And so recognizing your type can be, it can be humbling, it can be hard to kind of come to that understanding of what your type is. But once you do understand your type, it makes it a lot easier for you to find the monologues that are best for you. It'll also help you understand when you're specifically choosing a monologue with the goal of stretching yourself or breaking out of your mold, breaking out of your type. So you got to understand what your type is to start off with.
Yeah, it's very important. And as like, I've got way more experience critiquing and monologues as a director than I have presenting monologues. And I'm always, I'm evaluating actors based on, do I feel like they are, as said, like the, what they're presenting is, fits this, my idea for this character. And so, not that I'm always going with, I pick the actor that fits my, what my mold.
But as directors, we have a preconceived notion.
And you can tell, you can always tell when someone is auditioning way outside their range, or what, not necessarily their range, but just like you have a you know, if you had a 9-year-old man who's reading a part for a 13-year-old girl, right? It's more jarring than it is an exhibition of their skill, right? And so you kind of have to understand what you're doing if you're going off type, right? You're trying to show something very specific off, and that's part of your valuation of this monologue, right? Does this show something that I'm good at off, right? Like, is this prove to the director that I can do, and you have a specific variable in mind, right? Does this show my flexibility as an actor? Does this show my dramatic range, right? Does this show that I'm comedic? Does this show that I can cry on command? You know, like, what is this thing that I'm trying to show in this, and is this my best skill, right?
Right, and that's what I want to come back to, your audition. And just to clarify, this video is not going to be much about, like, how to audition or how to do a good audition. We're talking about how to select a monologue, but the two are really interrelated, really intertwined. So keep in mind when you're choosing a monologue for an audition, you're looking for the best version of yourself. So this is not the time where you want to go way outside of your comfort zone.
Yeah.
If you don't know how to juggle, don't choose a monologue where you have to juggle.
Yeah.
So look at something that does show off. If you're really good as a 90-year-old man at playing a 13-year-old girl, then go for it. Right, that shows you at your best.
Yes.
But make those choices where it's going to show your strengths rather than pushing you. Callbacks and things like that, that's where you go into stretching and where you go into trying out new stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Your initial audition, that initial monologue should be the best that you can present.
Yeah. You want to present your best rather than perhaps highlight things that you can't do the greatest, right? Mm-hmm. Because those will stick out, especially like I'm a very positive director. I'm all about like, you know, everybody can do anything with enough training. Mm-hmm. But if you do something wrong, I notice that first, right? and then I will push past to what did I see that was right. But not every director is as gracious as me. and that's how I already am. I'm working from, I see the things that are wrong, and then I go and see the potential. And so if you bring juggling to an audition that is, and it was C-minus juggling, you know, like, it was like, yeah, you caught all of them, but I could clearly tell we were focused more on that than the monologue, you know, whatever the problem with the juggling was. This video is not about juggling.
or is it?
Yeah, it might become a video about juggling. And And so that's what I'll see first. Mm-hmm. And it will distract from, you might have a killer monologue that you juggled in, and then I forgot about the good monologue because you juggled poorly.
Yeah, and that's definitely more about a technique of audition.
Yes.
Kind of thing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But it is, in this case, it's about, you've selected a monologue that has put you in a position to do something.
Right, that distracts from yourself.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So to circle back around and talk about type, so mm-hmm. how might an actor, especially if I'm an actor and I'm struggling with trying to figure out what my type is, do you have any like words of advice? How does somebody go about finding type?
If you've worked with other people, that's a great way to, you can tap people that you know well and that you have good dramatic instincts, and that's like, or comedic, or whatever you've worked on. If you really are struggling to understand yourself and your type, they will tell you, because your type is almost always obvious to everybody else. Like, because it is just kind of your default. It's what you're presenting to the world. Especially, and when you do plays and you work with people, they'll get a sense of how you act. And so you can ask your fellow actors, ask the director that you've worked with before, to get a sense. What I would do. Do you have anything that you?
Yeah, I would definitely recommend. Even though it might seem like a good choice, I would not ask my best friend.
Oh yes.
Or a family member, because they're going to be kind to you.
Yes.
They're always going to try to not hurt your feelings. Unless you've got like a best friend who you know, lays it out as it is and doesn't hold back, or they understand the purpose behind the question.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I would say looking, going to other theater people and getting feedback from them about what your type might be. And then being open to that, you need to, as an actor, you need to be receptive of that information, because yes, you can absolutely audition against type, and I encourage that, but there's a balance when you're auditioning that you want to think about. Do you want to express yourself and stretch yourself as an artist, or do you want to work? What's your priority at that moment?
Yeah.
And if you just want to work, you want to know what, you're a product then, and what is your product that you need to sell?
Mm-hmm. And often the stretching yourself can come inside a role that is on type too, right? You can work with your director. I mean, every director's different, but like some directors will be like, it's like, hey, can I try this line, or can I try this character a little bit more X, Y, or Z? And they'll often be open to that. A lot of directors are really hungry for input too, because the director is looking at every single character, right? And actors looking at their character every time. And so that's a way to kind of, you can do both. You don't really want to go so far off type in the aisle. Basically what we've already mentioned about, you need to understand your type. Right. Especially if you're going to go off type, you really need to understand your type, to understand why you're going off type.
Yeah.
One of the things you can do to figure out your type, if you have no resources currently, is to go to like a local theater that you haven't worked with and like schedule time with one of their directors or their people.
Mm-hmm.
Or someone who's teaching a class on acting, because they've worked with all sorts of actors, and they have no obligation to be nice to you.
Right.
So they'll give you the real truth.
Yeah. Great. There's another thing about type that I feel is important that we touch on, especially in today's world.
Yeah.
Which is recognizing like ethnic identifiers, gender identifiers, things like that. So there's a big movement, especially up here in the Seattle area and other big metropolitan areas, about opening up roles that do showcase ethnic diversity or different ableness of bodies or gender identities, that those roles be cast with actors who fit those types.
Mm-hmm.
And that goes into your audition as well. Even 10 years ago, I think this wouldn't have been such a big deal, but... Mm-hmm. Make sure that you're not auditioning for a role that's outside of your ethnic group or gender identity or sexual identity. Just don't do it. I was going to say unless you have a really good reason, but I think in today's world, it's best just not to do those things. So if you're, you know, like if I've got a really great monologue from an August Wilson play, this is, It's a thing for me to enjoy by myself. It's not something for me to perform out in public. So just kind of be aware of that.
Yeah. As a director, if you've selected a monologue that is offensive to me, right, you basically have guaranteed you're not going to be cast, right? Especially if I'm working on making a play and a product as a director that is palatable to a wider audience or just to an audience in general, I am not going to select someone who has essentially demonstrated by choosing a monologue that is offensive that they can't read the room, right? It shows, even if it's like, oh, this is fantastic, you've chosen one factor. It's like, oh, I'm really good at this specific thing, and you've ignored this other large offensiveness component. It shows me that you're not necessarily all the way in touch with the culture, and that you're probably not going to reach out to an audience as well for that very reason. So it kind of, even if that's not necessarily true about you, that's what it feels like in the audition. And so
it's a rough first impression.
It's a very rough first impression.
And that's another really good point, Joren, is understanding the company that you're auditioning for. Mm-hmm. So when you're choosing a monologue, there is kind of a, it's like an unspoken desire with actors that they feel like they need to shock or surprise with their monologues. And if, Joren, you direct a lot of plays at your local church.
Yeah.
And if I choose something from David Mamet where I'm coming in and I'm swearing 15 times in a monologue.
Yeah.
I might not offend you, but I'm not presenting something that's appropriate for your space, for your company.
Yeah, and you're definitely not getting cast if I can't trust that you're going to stay on script in that sense. Or like, you know, like there's the, if you make me worried, right, it reduces your value, right, as an actor to me as a director. And that's a part of like the cast, like not to get too much into the casting process rather than monologues, but everybody who comes in on auditions has a, even if I'm not using actual numbers, a score in my head, right? And so you might do one part fantastic and one part terrible and it averages out. And so if you don't understand the space that you're going for and what that's looking like, you could reduce your score as an actor by choosing something that doesn't fit with the ethos or the culture of the space that you are.
Right, commission of that. Group. Yeah. So along with doing your research on the play that you're going to audition for when you're looking for your monologue, you also want to understand the company that you're hoping to work for and understand what are their values, what are their goals, what's the, maybe finding out if you can about the kinds of shows that the director has done before. So understand the room that you're going to be walking into when you audition and how is that monologue going to help make you seem like you fit into their big picture. So that's another important piece. So we're looking for a monologue, right? We've done our research on the play. We've done our research on the company. We're ready to go.
Yeah.
So now I want to find a monologue. What do I do? I think a lot of people go to Google.
Yeah.
And because a lot of people go to Google, the first page, the first couple of pages are all of the monologues that everybody else is doing. Is that good?
No.
Don't, we're tired of seeing the same monologues. There's actually like, I think it's an unspoken list, but there is a list of monologues that as directors we're tired of seeing because we're guaranteed to see it at least once at every audition that we do.
Hamlet is all over the place.
Yeah, to be or not to be, stop it.
It's just like, yes, the monologue is compelling in the play Shakespeare, but I've, the play Shakespeare, in the play Hamlet, written by Shakespeare. but it's overdone, right? And so, this is what I ask. If you're going to do Hamlet, a soliloquy from Hamlet, you have to be the best, right?
You have to bring something new.
You have to be the best version of this soliloquy that I've ever seen. Or else it will fall into the pack of the millions that I've seen and you will be forgettable and you will not probably be cast.
Right. Well, I did. So I also direct plays at one of the local high schools. And the last two shows that we did, there's a monologue from You're a Good Man, Charlie Brown about Sally and her clothes hanger project. And I saw that monologue no less than a half dozen times in each one of those auditions.
Yeah.
And by the time you know, there's a lot of problems with that. So first of all, by the time the third person comes in, I realize that all three of you are paraphrasing, that you haven't learned it, because the monologue's slightly different every single time.
Yeah.
The words are a little bit different. And that matters to certain directors. Like you've said, some directors are real sticklers.
Yeah.
Others are looser. But that's going to affect the director. Plus, our business in the theater is to entertain. Mm-hmm. And if I'm sitting through the same monologue over and over and over again, and nobody's bringing anything new to it, mm-hmm. I'm no longer being entertained.
Yeah,
you're not showing me anything special or anything compelling, or it doesn't feel like there's a lot of thought if you bring in one of these monologues that are overdone. And I think it's also important to know that that list kind of cycles.
Yeah.
Because you get to a list, okay, the clothes hanger monologue or to be or not to be mm-hmm. is way overdone. Nobody do it. So nobody does it for 5 years.
Yeah.
And then somebody comes in and does it after 5 years and you're like, oh, I haven't heard this in so long. How nice.
I remember why it's you know, I remember why those guys like Shakespeare so much.
Right. Yeah. He kind of knew what he was doing.
Yeah. He kind of had a cadence about him that's kind of nice.
Right. So I would say if you're going to do the Google search for the monologue, skip the first page of your results. Move down in the list so that you're doing some work. And then to go back to what I said before, when you do find some on Google that you like, then find the plays that they're from and read the plays.
One of the huge things for a monologue, and this is really very clear in Shakespeare, so Shakespeare's a pretty good example, is that if you don't understand what's happening around your monologue, you're not going to realize why some of those words are being said, right? Mm-hmm. And you will then, if you don't know why a word's being said, you're not going to say it right, right? And for the most case, a lot of directors are theater nerds, right? You don't have a lot of directors who have not read the Shakespeare's, right?
The Shakespeare's,
right? You don't have a lot of directors who are not like, they at least have an idea of what that line is supposed to be about. So if you get that wrong, you've lost a little trust with that director. It's like, oh, they're not going to interpret every line correctly. Well, I'm either have to do that work for them, or I'm going to find somebody else who has better instincts for it. Which is another part of choosing a cliched monologue is, if I've heard the same people do it in the same audition bracket, right? It's, you're going to fall behind. You basically, like I said earlier, if you're not the absolute best, right? And that's the thing. When you're auditioning for something, you're not really trying to show that you're the best at this kind of thing. You want to show yourself to your best.
Right.
So that we can use you where you are, where you fit best, right? And that is harder to do if you're competing in a crowd. And so choosing
it. Yeah, it's harder to stand out that way and show your individuality. Yeah, absolutely. So you can do the Google thing. That's definitely one way. It's an easy way for us nowadays to find monologues. But I can't stress this enough, don't shortchange yourself when it comes to reading the plays. If you can't find the play, and sometimes you just can't find the play. It might be a new work. It might be not available in your local library. And there's only so many plays available to read the entire text online, things like that. Mm-hmm. At least find the Wikipedia page or the Cliff's Notes or something like that and read so that, like Joren said, so you understand the overarching themes and the storyline.
And the context.
What's going on. Yeah, the context. So when you're looking for these monologues, there's a couple of things to be aware of when you're choosing a monologue for the stage. Mm-hmm. One of them is that theater people were kind of snobs. And so generally, monologues from movies and TV shows are not acceptable for a stage audition. Mm-hmm. The same isn't true the other way around. If you're auditioning for films and television, you're pretty much able to select from anything for your piece. But for the theater, you want to make sure that you're choosing something from a play and be aware of the director might want it to only be a published, produced play.
Yeah.
So if you're working on your great autobiographical play, if it hasn't been put on stage yet, then you might not want to go that route.
Yeah. And it's a huge part about understanding your the audience, the director, and the company that you're working for. those rules are vastly different between directors and yep. different companies. And if you're confused about that, just ask. They'll have rules for you. Like for me, I have no preference. I'm looking to just see what you can do, right? And so, but there is something to be said about monologues from film and TV. They aren't written like a stage play's monologue. They are meant sometimes to be subtler. They're meant because you can focus so close on the actor, or you can focus on their action, and there's a backing track to sell the mood. There's all sorts of different little things in film and theater, film and TV that aren't in theater, and so the lines get written differently.
Yep.
Right? In theater, because you're watching in a group of 100 people from many feet away, in most cases, you don't get these zooms and these pans, these transitions. It's written a little bit more overtly. It's written almost like a cartoon in a sense. Everything is clearer, right, on stage. Or it's written to be more flowery in that case. Also, the
more
tone.
Theatrical.
Yeah, more theatrical. The tone has to be set by the actor a lot more than the things around the actor in film and TV. And so you can choose a film or TV monologue that is really flat when delivered, just you on stage,
right?
Right, because it's you don't, especially in the audition space, it's you in terrible lighting, you with no mic,
with no soundtrack,
right? There's no soundtrack, right? They haven't seen the scene before it, right? They don't know what the context is, and so it could essentially be real flat, you know, and that will affect your chances. It really won't let us see who you are as an actor better, and so.
And I want to hit on something that you mentioned a couple of times to make sure that people watching understand this, is that any advice that Joren and I give, you got to understand that every director is different,
yeah,
and every situation is going to be different. So we're kind of talking in broad terms, but there are going to be times when that monologue from Serpico is going to be exactly the way to
exactly.
go, or Star Wars, or whatever you want to do, that's going to be a good choice. Sometimes you can break the conventions in order to show yourself off at your very best.
Yeah.
So if you're really good at maybe playing subtle, playing things in a more cinematic yeah. type of way, and you have learned ways to translate that into stage work, maybe that is the best way to go. Just recognize that if that's how you choose your monologue, you're taking a risk.
Yeah.
So make it a deliberate risk.
Yeah. And that's... all of the things when choosing a monologue, it's like a list of factors that go into like a total score,
right?
Like it's a final. And like when I'm rating actors, I actually will do it with scores and certain things where it's like this actor was X, Y, or Z number good at this factor. I use that to create a little sheet. It's same thing works for monologues, right? You could be like, oh, this is a cinematic thing. And so it kind of takes away a little bit here. But because I'm just freaking killer at these other parts of it, it's still my best monologue for this choice, right? Which is a part of why we're talking about how there's all these different criteria that go into a monologue, right? And that's why picking a monologue is as complex as it is because it's a moving target, right? And so you want to have all of these different factors to be considered when choosing a monologue because you will need to know... Sometimes it's when to break the rules, right?
Yep.
And I like you were saying earlier that like there's this built-in need or desire from an actor to shock in their monologue, right? Because they want to stand out. And sometimes that is exactly what you need to do, right? Because it will make you stand out. Sometimes you need to pick a safer one that fits in with your skill set.
And just nail it.
And just absolutely nail it. And knowing the difference between those is a sum total of knowing all of the different, you know.
You got to know when to hold them and know when to fold them.
Know when to fold them. Exactly. That's exactly right.
Yeah, so going back into this for finding your monologue, I would also encourage you to not go with monologues that are anonymous, that don't have a playwright attached to it, don't have a play. attached to it, because those monologues a lot of times just don't have the depth of character, the depth of story that we're looking for. They might be really great for classwork, but they don't often carry the kind of the oomph that you need for your audition piece. So I'd recommend staying away from those. Also, because I know I do this in auditions all the time. If the actor doesn't include the name of the play or the playwright in their slate, then I'll ask them, you know, oh, what play is this from? Especially if I haven't heard it before and I want to find out. And if the actor says, if they say it's there is no author or I couldn't find it, then I tend to, even though it might be wrong, I tend to doubt their credibility a little bit. Because there's another thing that actors sometimes try to do when they're finding a monologue, which is they try to write their own. And I highly discourage writing your own monologue because a lot of times they don't have an end. They just kind of, you just kind of go on and on and on, and then it fizzles, and then it affects your entire audition that way.
Yeah, don't improv a monologue. Doesn't matter how good you are at it.
So there's another thing where people try to write their own monologues.
Yeah.
And bring that into the audition. Don't recommend doing that. Even if you're really good at improv or you're a really good writer, whatever it might be, we can kind of tell the monologues kind of tend to go on for too long before they start to make a point or where you can buy in. If you're improvising, you know, with improv, sometimes it takes a while to warm up into the improv.
Yeah, I would know.
Joren, this is your specialty.
So
it can take a little while before the monologue like catches the director's attention, and then suddenly you're at 2 minutes and you haven't done the thing that you wanted to do. It also can come across as a little arrogant.
Yeah, very pretentious.
The best monologue I could find is this one that I wrote.
Yeah.
Better than any of the Shakespeare's.
None of the Shakespeare's.
Right.
Well, one of the things that I find about self-written stuff, even if it's fantastic, is inherently it's the first time I've digested it, right? And so if you do a monologue that at least I'm familiar with the theme of the play, or that I know what the play it's from.
Or the playwright.
Or the playwright, any of that kind of stuff, it gives me a starting point for understanding the monologue, right? And so I have nowhere context to come from, I have to do that all on the fly, and then it's harder for me to really know if it was good or not, right? And it could be later on down the line, 3 months later, and I'm still thinking about the audition because it was the best monologue I've ever heard, right? But I would never know at that time, and it probably already cast it by the time that I've got to the round to really understanding your monologue. And so you lose value there if I haven't ever heard of any of the different pieces of it.
Right. And that's a great thing to think about also when you're choosing your monologue, is a good audition monologue is going to have, it's going to grab your attention right away. You don't want the director to be zoned out, to still be thinking about the person that came before you. You need a monologue that's going to, and this partially goes into your performance of the monologue, but it needs to grab the director's attention right away.
Yeah.
Make us look up from the paper, watch what you're doing, and really be focused on that. And then it also needs to end strong. We'll talk more about all of these things when we talk about like how to do your audition. But part of that is choosing a piece that is real concise and really tight.
Yeah. Evaluating a monologue based on its completeness just by itself is important. Another reason why there's value in choosing a famous monologue, if it's not cliche, is I, as a director, probably have already some context, right? And so I come with a little bit of, I know where this is going, and so I can get hooked easier.
Or I've heard about this play.
Yeah, exactly. All that kind of stuff is potentially value. And if you don't have any of that, so if you choose something very obscure, right, which is not necessarily a problem, you want your monologue to have a hook at the beginning, right? You want your monologue to have some sort of intrigue in the center and then a conclusion at the end. It needs to be a three-act play just in its...
Exactly. There's an arc to your monologue. The character ends up, even at the end of the monologue, they end up somewhere different than they started.
Which is why
you don't want to choose a monologue that's like a, I remember the time.
Yes.
A reminiscing sort of, you're just sitting in your rocking chair on the front porch.
Yeah.
telling about this thing that happened to your character before.
Yeah.
Because that's not an active monologue. There's nothing happening to the character. There's no urgency.
Yeah, you remove all the stakes.
Exactly.
From it, right? It's, if this is in the past, then I don't really care. You know? Right. Whereas those monologues can work in a larger scenario because it's not just the monologue, it's the whole play, right? Right. But when you are just doing the monologue, right, the goal is to hook us, show us something, and land the plane. Right. And, it's harder to do that with passive monologues.
Yeah, and kind of what you were talking about, the reverse is also true. So let's say that you did the Shakespeare play.
Yeah.
And you loved it, and it was a great experience. You loved performing it. So then you choose your monologue from that play because you love it so much, whatever play it might be. But when you take the play out of context and you read it by itself, it doesn't make sense. Mm-hmm. Or there is no impact. It doesn't offer growth.
Mm-hmm.
So you want to make sure that that monologue stands alone as a compelling piece of theater.
Yeah.
So you do want to know how it fits into the full play.
Yeah.
But can it stand alone and tell a story? There's a great monologue. There's a play called The Cemetery Club that I produced a few years back. Beautiful, beautiful monologue at the end about death and rebirth and like accepting the cycle and all that stuff. It's a gorgeous monologue. And you take it out of the play, and it has no impact whatsoever. Mm-hmm. Because it's about the relationships of the characters that are on stage at that time. And without that, it's just kind of this free-floating, people, you know, just pontificating, but without any real consequence.
Yeah.
So like you said, it needs to have stakes.
Yeah.
There needs to be a purpose behind whatever monologue you choose.
And this is getting back to, I think, our main... point and suggestion, which is read plays, really helps, because the more plays you read, the more you're going to find not just famous monologues, but you'll find little sections, monologues that are well done, that have the full structure of a good audition monologue, that are just completely obscure, right? Mm-hmm. And or that are not famous. They're not going to come up on a Google search because they're not one of the 10 famous best monologues, right? And so getting your hands on plays is really important. Even if you don't really find anything you like in those plays, reading those plays will help your analysis of other monologues too. You will be like, oh, this is a bad one. Like, you realize that this is a fine play, this is a bad monologue in this fine play that you won't really realize until you've read a bunch of other plays. And so if you've only ever read plays that you've done or like in a scholastic environment where you're learning the play as you're practicing and researching it, you're never really going to be familiar with the structure of a monologue.
No, because how many plays does an actor do in a year? Maybe 4, 5 at the most, if you're really working.
Yeah.
If you're working nonstop, that's not... 4 plays in a year, you're not learning anything about theater.
Yeah. So you're just learning those plays.
Yeah. And I do, off of what you're saying, one more thing about choosing a monologue before, I'd like to talk a little bit about reading plays and like how to do that. But you can also, when you're auditioning, you can take, you can build a monologue by taking, if you've got a scene that's dialogue between two characters, if you can edit that down to where you just take out the other voice and it still works as a monologue that way. There's a lot of great, especially in comedies, it's hard to find a monologue because it's just bam, 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 bam with dialogue.
Yeah.
So if you can squeeze that together, that's perfectly acceptable for your audition monologue, is to edit, cobble together a monologue, as long as it still has a through line, it's got a story arc, and it's compelling.
Yeah. Some of the most compelling monologues that I've seen have had these giant chunks of like space for other people's dialogue that isn't there. It's almost a little bit of a hack because like, oh, they stop talking, like I need to listen in, and then they continue talking, and then it makes me imagine the other side of the joke. But it can be a compelling way of telling a story, is forcing me to imagine the other side of the dialogue.
Or just edit it so you turn a line into your character's line or something like that. So you don't want to perform a scene of dialogue as a monologue. So where you're this character and then you respond, don't do that.
Definitely don't do that.
Right. Unless you're auditioning for Joren, he'll love it.
I mean, I will love it and then not cast you. there, it'll be all about garbage. I'll be like, oh, that was fantastic. And
it was the weirdest thing I've ever seen.
We'll see you at the next audition. Yeah. I mean, you know.
So reading plays, okay, let's say I'm brand new to theater.
Yeah.
Or I've only, like you said, I've only done the plays that I've done.
Yeah.
This is a real issue. When I was 20, I got involved with my first theater company.
Mm-hmm.
And I was invited to sit on their play production committee, which is the group that chooses the plays mm-hmm. to present for the season. The only plays I knew at that point were the plays that I had done.
Yeah.
The popular Shakespeare's.
Yeah.
And everything Neil Simon wrote. That was it. That was all I knew. So I felt like I couldn't really contribute to the conversation much mm-hmm. when it came to selecting shows. So if you're brand new to this idea of reading plays, how do you, you know, when you start reading plays, if you read a couple of stinkers in a row, you're not going to want to read anymore.
Yeah.
Right? It's going to, all of the fun is going to be taken out of it.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you dive into that reading of plays and have it be rewarding and exciting? Yeah. And do you have any thoughts on?
Well, I know I generally will start with like, if I've watched a play that mm-hmm. I liked, I will read that. I will find and read that script. I just often will be looking to watch plays, and there are a lot of resources online to watch different versions, right?
Yeah.
Even if they're like community theater versions, they help. They can often help get a sense of the play. For me, it really helps my analysis of a play to see it also performed. I want to see a version of it.
Sure.
So that I can push and pull. And then if I like that play, I can read the script. And then often I will find it more enjoyable if I've already watched it. Because I'm like, oh, I know what that's supposed to mean now.
You know? Right. and that's what you said at the beginning is a really good point. A play that you've been in, because if you were in it, chances are you were reading for the role of Bob.
Yeah.
And that's what you were focused on was Bob's lines and Bob's character mm-hmm. and all of that. Go back after the play's closed and read the play and look at it as a piece mm-hmm. of literature in its entirety.
Yeah.
There's a great way to get into like really reading plays.
Yeah. And I'd read classics. Like I'd read the All-Stars, right? Like mm-hmm. As well. A part of the benefit of doing that is it kind of puts you in the same a state of learning as a director, right? They've often read all of the classics or they've at least participated in making them, you know, if they've been in or directed shows. And so you kind of, it gives you a common ground for them with a director, which can help you evaluate what makes a monologue better. And classics are generally classics for a reason. It's not always the case. There are some stinkers, I think.
Some that were great, and then the world changed.
Exactly.
And now stinkers.
there's some plays that, like, why is this still going on? I don't, right? I mean, technically, this is theater, but still, reading those can have value. And you're probably going to a higher percentage than if you're just trying to find brand new plays that are coming out.
Mm-hmm.
If you have local theater company that you have connections with, they often have plays and things for you to read.
I can't imagine any theater, if you were to walk into a theater and say, I'm interested in theater, but I don't know where to find scripts.
Yeah.
I can't imagine any theater going, too bad.
Too bad.
They're going to be like, here's a stack.
Yeah.
Come back, because for me, I've got 30, 40 scripts on my desk at any time that mm-hmm. I haven't read yet that I want to.
Yeah.
And I'll be like, Joren, read these and tell me if they're any good.
Yeah.
Because mm-hmm. I can't get to them all.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, I'm the same way with, I've just got a pile of scripts to evaluate.
Yeah.
At any given moment, right? And so, if you go to your local theater company, they're going to have stuff, probably, to help you begin reading. And if you go to a company that's already producing plays, they're going to probably have an opinion on good and bad plays to help you, like, oh, I really like this play.
What works for their audience.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Like, we did really well with this play. If you want to read this play, we like it. Getting help in that manner. That's just good advice for every piece of theater training everywhere. Like, doesn't matter what it is, go talk to somebody else and have them get input on your selections of monologues, right? Mm-hmm. this is true about everything. Like, you're going to do an audition, record yourself doing the audition, and then evaluate it, and have a friend evaluate it, and do the same thing with your monologue selections. Like, I'm thinking about doing these 5 monologues, right? Like, for over the course of, and someone will go, you know, I really don't like this monologue because it comes across a little X, Y, bad. Bad. Just bad.
Right. It's bad for whatever, any number of reasons.
And they'll also say this one is good. And that's what you can do everywhere in any endeavor. It doesn't even have to be theater. This is just good advice for your life. Review your own work. Have somebody else review your work. Don't just do the work. You will improve 10 times faster if you have a little bit more of a reflection on yourself and with group and others.
And if you get somebody who does give you the feedback, then try, if you can, try and press them for a why.
Mm-hmm.
So if they liked it or they didn't like it, try and find out why. Because if somebody doesn't like it, maybe it's because the character in the monologue is a jerk. And so that's good, them saying that they don't like it.
Mm-hmm.
So try and dig a little deeper. Don't just be like, oh, it wasn't good, right? So I'm not going to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Find out why, so that then you can evaluate whether it fits your purpose or it doesn't. So when you're out and you're trying to read plays now, right? So you've got the couple that you've been in, maybe you've been to the theater or the library or something, and you found what's there. So that gets you started. So then what you do is, Joren, you kind of mentioned this, like you like to read the classics.
Mm-hmm.
In theater terms, the classics are kind of like from the 1930s back. So the stuff in the 40s, 50s, and 60s, that's called contemporary theater.
Mm-hmm.
And then anything beyond that is new theater. So anything from the 70s forward is new theater. So in terms of like reality, that doesn't match anything. But so if somebody says, oh, from the contemporary plays is where you need to choose a monologue from, they mean Arthur Miller and Edward Albee and Tennessee Williams and all those guys.
Mm-hmm.
And Lillian Hellman, the one female.
That was writing plays at the time.
Yeah, that got famous during that time. But that's kind of what they're talking about. So it's important to understand the lingo also what the director's looking for. But you find something, let's say that it's Lillian Hellman.
Yeah.
And you read a play and you like what she wrote. And you don't know where to go from there. So what you do is then you read another Lillian Hellman play.
Yeah.
Until you've gone through and you've read all of her plays that you have access to.
Mm-hmm.
Then from there, you branch out and you say, okay, who else was writing at this time?
Mm-hmm.
Because I like this style. Right? Or if you don't like this style, then you say, okay, who else was writing at this time? I'm going to avoid them.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But make those judgments based on what you have read. If you like it, look for more of the same.
Yeah.
If you don't like it, go to someplace else.
This is kind of a little silly to even say, but the evaluating, if you like a play and you like a monologue, that's a pretty good indicator that it's good, you know? Mm-hmm. The person with the lowest amount of drama instincts, where it's just not natural for them, all the different pieces, will like good theater, right? And so that's the easiest and the most simple test to start evaluating a monologue is, did you like the monologue, right?
Mm-hmm.
If you liked it, even if you don't know why you liked it, that's a good starting place, right? You go, oh, I like this monologue. I'm going to make a note of that. I like this monologue. And then you can come back to it later and start doing a more in-depth analysis, or you can bring it to somebody you know can do the in-depth analysis if you're like, I like this monologue. Can you help me evaluate it?
Right.
If you have a Joren in your life, they would absolutely love to do analysis for you.
And who doesn't need a Joren?
Everyone wants a Joren in your life, right? Yeah. Here's my number up on the screen. You can call me if you need help.
Speaking of up on the screen, though, we are going to, at the end of the video, we're going to have a list of, like, the top playwrights, the playwrights that every actor should be familiar with. Mm-hmm. That doesn't necessarily mean that you have to read every single play that all of these play. It's a pretty big list.
Yeah, I haven't read half of these.
Yeah, but these are the most influential from classic or contemporary theater. Some of the names that we put on here are the big names that are happening right now. And they might have only written 2 plays that's been published at this point, but they're revolutionary,
the
or that they're the ones really making waves right now. that should be read. So make sure that you check the end of this video so that you get that list of playwrights. It'll also be in the description down below. Mm-hmm. So you can access those. It's
flashing on the screen right now.
Right.
Just pause when it flashes on if you need it.
Yeah. Train of thought. Okay. So you're talking, Joren, about evaluating your monologue, filming it, getting a second opinion.
Yeah.
We have monologues.
We do.
We have some monologues that were submitted.
Fantastic. I didn't even plan that.
Right. I know. What a great... You are the segue master.
I am the king of segues. Okay. Completely unrelated. I don't know why I'm putting this on film.
Is this a segue?
This is a segue about segues. Did you know that the CEO of Segway died on a Segway? The guy who owned the Segway company, right? Oh. And or invented it. I don't know. The facts are loose. Just jostle around in there.
So he used a Segway to segue into the next
life? Yeah, he segued right into the next life. I think he went off a cliff or something on a Segway. Just a fantastic little tidbit. A little bit morbid. Sorry. We can maybe cut that out in post. All right. Chris or Layton will...
It's the key to this whole video is the Segway. Yeah, so let's watch some monologues, and Joren and I are going to kind of give, again, we're not looking at the performance of the audition itself, but we're going to try and just focus on the material.
Evaluating the choice.
Yeah, the monologues that were selected for
a bit of the audition performance is going to go into reviewing the monologue selection in the sense that it's like, oh, this was a good choice because you could do this with it. Right, in the sense, but yeah, we'll focus on the choice of the monologue. Right.
And with each of these actors, I asked them to kind of talk a little bit about why they had selected it, what they might use the monologue for. So is it a dramatic piece or a comedic piece, or what would they use it for? Some of them have given more information, some have given less.
Alrighty.
And then I do also have the benefit that I know all of these actors.
Yeah.
So when it comes to like their type,
you'll have this.
I know more about that, but I think it'll be interesting for you not knowing them to kind of get a sense of their type just by watching and see if it feels like it's a fitting piece for them to use. It's a fitting piece. All right. So the first video that we're going to watch is submitted by an actress named Megan. And neither one of us have watched any of these yet. So this is going to be brand new, as Joren put it, hot takes off of these. So here we go with Megan's monologue. If I can get it to play. Oh, Megan, here she goes.
This is a monologue from Finding the Sun by Edward Elley. You know, after we're done making love, we have our cigarettes, Daniel usually looks at me and smiles, holds my hand, and says, "Isn't it nice that we are just such good friends?" It isn't your usual form of marriage, isn't it? It isn't precisely the, "Hey babe, it was good for me, was it good for you too?" Nothing like that. But I don't mind. I think I prefer it. I think Daniel is more interested in our friendship than our marriage. I mean, like, he's not less happy that he's married to me than he would be to see Brandon. But if I were to lose anything, it won't be the usual way a marriage ends, you know, where the relationship ends, and then the marriage. I think once Daniel finally learns that our marriage is as silly as it is, well, then I lose a marriage. But I think I will still have a friend. There are worse things in life than that.
Okay. So
I just spent most of that video being like, wow, I really synced that. I really synced it up nice here on my silent take.
It was a one-time
deal. Fantastic.
So what I like about this monologue, like my first hit, is it has an arc.
Mm-hmm.
It took me on a journey.
Yeah.
She starts off, and part of this is her delivery, but it starts off kind of light and fun and about being together and about the niceness.
Yeah.
And then it goes into, well, what if we're not together?
Yeah.
So so it's a really nice choice because it is a journey. There's some stakes.
Yeah.
There's something for me to, there's a reason for me to care, basically.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I liked, this is silly to say, but there is a bit of a hook in the beginning where it's like, this monologue isn't just about anything. It's like, say, after we're done making love, and it's a little cliche to say that sex sells, but it inherently causes anybody to be like, oh, wait, what were we
doing? What was that?
You don't want to lean in so hard to that idea when choosing a monologue, like, let's pick the most obscene opening line, or you don't want to pick the most crazy opening line, but it is something to always consider. How does your monologue start, right? If I really wasn't paying that close attention, is there anything that's going to make me pay that close attention?
And we talked about that earlier. Yes. Get us to look up from the paper.
Yeah.
Yeah. Really nice. I think that she's talking about being married.
Yeah.
Which seems to fit her age range. She's not like she's not a little kid talking about being married. So I think that appropriateness of material was right.
Yeah.
And I think that she that it was good for her type because Megan is kind of an every person.
Mm-hmm.
And the foibles of relationships is something that almost every person deals with.
Yeah.
At some point in some way. And so it makes it a very relatable and accessible kind of monologue.
Yeah. Yeah, I totally agree. I think it comes across as like someone who's just thinking deeper about a relationship that doesn't, that can be off type for someone who seems like an airhead. Right, that could be off type for someone who seems like they're really, really sure of themselves. Right, if here we get kind of a just from the way that even just kind of the filming the video sideways, right, kind of gives you a sense of
which I hope Layton is going to fix for us.
Layton will fix in post. It is gives a sense that like this is someone who's like it. I didn't not believe she's contemplative as a person from what was presented, which is a good choice.
It's a very good choice because you don't want the director to get, you don't want anything to pull us out of the moment of watching you. And if you are, we're back to being a 13-year-old girl again, talking about how hard it is to be married and after you've made love, right? Mm-hmm. Immediately as directors are going to be like, hold, what? Wait.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that isn't the case with this. Mm-hmm. It did feel to where we could just say, oh yeah, of course.
Mm-hmm.
And we could agree. It's that yes and idea from improv, right?
From improv, yeah.
Yes, you're married. Great. Wonderful. And
tell me else about it. One of the things to start on the con list is while it had an arc, there was some context to it that like I could put together with some analysis, but I think I had to like, okay, what is this relationship like? I had to bring that to the thing fill in some holes. By the time the monologue ended, I'm there already. But if I'm not quick on my feet with that, I can lose a little bit of the monologue while I'm solving some of that. And when choosing a monologue, that's something to consider. And I think in this case, the rest of the monologue is fine, right? Like the monologue carried because of all of the other factors, but like, there are times when those holes become too big to fill.
Yeah.
And so, you know, if you have a monologue where I don't understand the context and I have to pull it up myself, that can be too much of a detriment.
Right. Yeah. There's one thing for me that I agree with it that really can pull me out of a monologue. It happens a little bit in Megan's monologue, but not too much for my taste. But the, if a monologue refers to too many other characters.
Yeah.
So you talk about Jody and Melissa and Kevin and Mike and all of those names are included in your monologue. I have no idea who those people were.
Yeah.
Right. And this one, she references one other person. So it isn't overwhelming.
Yeah.
And I can surmise that it's her boyfriend or her husband.
Yeah.
Or whatever. But if you're talking about, you know, Susie did this and then Billy did this and it's too much.
Yeah.
And that's one of those moments where it might be a great monologue in the play, but it's not a great standalone monologue.
Yeah.
So be aware of that when you're selecting your pieces. Is it self-contained?
Yeah.
How much work does the director or the audience have to do?
Yeah. And in this play, this monologue specifically, there's only one person, but I did at the beginning be like, okay, are they friends or are they actually married, right? I solved that, and I think by the end of it, it's like, okay, well, they are actually married, it sounds like. But that takes some of my brain power away from critiquing the monologue.
Right.
Now I'm understanding the narrative.
You're pulled away for a second.
Right?
Yeah.
And the monologue can only handle so much of that, right? Like, in this case, I think you're not, like, losing the part for what's in there. But when evaluating a monologue, that's something to consider, right?
Yeah.
Is that, is there too much context that needs to be inferred, right? And inferred context isn't always bad if it's just very clear, right? Like, if I know exactly what the answer is immediately, that can even provide value because this is just like a trick. It's like how a joke works, right? If I infer value and then twist on it, but infer value and being correct just has a reward, is a natural reward for an audience member or anyone intaking media.
They're right. Like, let's the audience be intelligent.
It's like, I got that right. That's value, and that value will pass along to you as an actor if you can do that part well. You just have to make sure, is it clear? Is it always clear? One of the ways to evaluate that, if you don't have a good sense right away, is to ask the question. Like, so do the monologue for a bunch of people and say, who is David in this case, right? And they go, David was her husband. David was her boyfriend. David was someone she's sleeping with. And if they get if 9 out of 10 people get the answer right, you're probably safe. The director is going to get the answer right too, right? If like 5 of them are wrong, it's like, okay, that monologue is not clear who this person is.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, it's confusing information.
Mm-hmm.
The last thing I want to say about this one is, by naming the play and the playwright, I haven't read this particular play, but she said it's by Edward Albee, who I'm very familiar with some of his work. I've read about 4 or 5 of his plays. So I had an idea going into it of what the tone was going to be about. So it helps me as a director. Again, I was immediately connected because, I felt smart. Mm-hmm. Oh, I know who that playwright is. And so I was drawn in immediately because of that aspect. So that has some value to it. The same can work the other way. If you list a play and a playwright I'm not familiar with, it might spur a little conversation after your audition where the director says, oh, where did you find this play? Or or who is this playwright? Or just to gather some more information so that I can build my knowledge up a little bit more. Maybe I decide I want to read this play based on your monologue. All right, I'd like to move on to the next tape that we have. So this will be Erin, female Erin. We have two Erin submissions here.
Erin with the E.
Erin with an E. All right, let's see if I can get this to play easier than last time. There we go.
Hi, my name is Erin Carter, and this is Maggie from The Shadow Box by Michael Christopher. This is a monologue I use for generals, and I would use in a general situation for a straight play or for... any type of wife role. This is, she's a wife talking to her husband. No, I want you to come home. What is this place anyway? They make everything so nice. See, forget. I can't. I want you to come home. I want you to stay out 4 nights a week bowling so you can come home late and I can yell and not talk to you, you son of a bitch. I want to fight, so you take me to a movie. But by the time I get you to take me, I'm so upset I can't enjoy it. I want to wake up too early. Too goddamn early. And I'll let you know about it too. Because you wake me up too early. Because I gotta make you breakfast, because you never, ever, once... eat it. because you want somebody to talk to. Keep you company, and it's dark, and it's cold, and my back aches, and we never have anything to talk about anyway. And it's all right, it's all right. Because I want to be there, because you need me to be there. Because I want you to be there, because I want you to come home. I want you to come home.
All right.
Cool.
Yeah.
What do you think? First hits on this one?
I think the emotional tone fits the obvious type really, really gels really well together. Right? So that, like, she's chosen a monologue here, and it begins, she's a general, this is like for a housewife kind of role, right? She's chosen this. And all that stuff really gels together. And it also shows that she's thinking about the part when she's putting together her audition. Mm-hmm. And so the monologue kind of matches the part, matches the her own type. And those things all gel really well together. She's put together a, I am this for this role. And if I had that role in my play, she's already at the top of the list, right? Like, she's like, okay, I have a housewife. But, like, right. The thing that she's definitely a major contender based on a bunch of other factors, but she's already right there. It's not like I have to fit her in somewhere in the play, which can happen. I'll have a really good audition that I just can't use because I don't
have... Right, don't know where to put her.
I don't know where to put that actor. Whereas this person has said, I'm exactly this. Let me show you how I can knock exactly this out of the park. And that's what she's done, you know? Like, it's in that way, fantastic choice for a monologue, right? Like, because of the, so many things that are lined up in a row there.
Right. And that's one of the things that really struck me about this one is on the previous one, we talked about the arc and the way that that worked. This one doesn't have an arc as much, but it has a journey. It is a straight line, like you said.
Yeah.
But it's a line that still goes somewhere.
Yeah.
You're not just sitting there. There's a lot of repetition in this monologue, which could get repetitive. It could get redundant and boring.
Yeah, and it could also be repetitive.
Yeah, yes, and repetitive as well.
Yeah, slightly redundant.
Right. So what she did is Erin recognized the emotional through line of that, and she... As the monologue continued, she doubled down on that, and that still gave us a journey.
Yeah.
So it still went somewhere.
Yeah.
It was the same basic idea, but it became more. Mm-hmm. The stakes got higher as the monologue went through. And some of that is from her performance, but it's also, if you pay attention to the writing, you could look at this and say, oh, she's really saying like four sentences over and over again. Mm-hmm. This is a bad monologue.
Yeah.
No, it isn't. Not necessarily.
Yeah. And your ability to perform a monologue affects your monologue choices, right?
Yes.
If you go, you know what, this monologue is stale inherently, but I see potential in doing it this way, or the first half muted, the second half crying, you know, that kind of thing, all this can add life to a monologue that's bad, and it should be a part of your evaluation.
So if you read a monologue that isn't that great, it could still be a good choice because of it's right on for your type, you enjoy doing it, and you can connect to the emotional through line of it.
Yeah, and I was gonna say the same thing, is that this monologue is just one idea, right? But it is still gripping because of the emotional connection that stays just on type the whole time. Like, it's believable, and you feel the emotions, and that in itself is gripping. And so you can put a lot of value into that if you can essentially have that gripping emotional connection to the to the piece. But yeah, like you're saying, like if I were to do this flat, right, or muted, or like that the sadness of the husband being gone is caused me to be muted, which is a very natural reaction and might be how you would think to play it, you'd probably lose me halfway through the monologue. I get it, right? He's not there and you want him to be, you know?
So look at your strengths when you're choosing a monologue like this. If this isn't your strength, then this is not, it could be a great monologue for somebody and a terrible monologue for somebody else.
Yeah.
Right. I do also want to address the language, which I think for YouTube we bleeped out. Thanks, Layton.
Yep. Good job, but Layton or Chris.
When you're choosing the, when you are choosing the monologue, recognize the swearing again. Make sure that it's appropriate for the company you're going to audition for. The, you know, if you're auditioning for the Wizard of Oz to play Dorothy, leave the swearing for another monologue, right?
Yeah.
For another audition. Recognize it's there. I have a tendency, because I'm very comfortable with swearing,
yeah,
that I can read a script or read a monologue and sometimes it doesn't even register.
Yeah, it's, yeah.
Because I'm like, yeah, that's normal. Yeah, you would, I would use that word in that instance. And so it feels very natural, so I don't pay attention to it. So so make sure that you're in tune with those kinds of things when you're choosing your piece. But yeah, I thought another really great, appropriate, compelling monologue. Let's hope one of these is terrible.
No, yeah, I was going to say, because there's always room for improvement everywhere, what would you say is the least, or what took away from the most value, or the worst part of what is otherwise a good model?
I think for this one, and this, I'd have to go back and watch it again since we only watched it once, but I feel like without Aaron's performance, I feel like the monologue doesn't have a strong ending on its own in the writing. I think that she solved for that.
Yeah.
But I'd have to check it again because it has a really strong beginning. No, I want you to stay. That's a strong beginning.
Yeah.
A one-word sentence at the beginning of the monologue almost always will get attention.
I would have said the same thing. We end up in the same place that we started, right? I know that the point of a monologue is I want you to stay by the first point.
I
don't really need you to expand on it for me to understand the narrative, right? And so, you know, you could pick a monologue that travels a little bit, or even one that has like I'm not going to give you the answer to the question until the end, right? That would allow some more payoff at the end. Because I think at the end, aside from the emotional elevation, right, there was no like, reveal.
Yeah, we weren't in a new place.
We're in a new place, and so there was no, the ending was not weak by any means, but like it was like, and we just are done now on some level. There was no, and that could have been a different choice. Might have had a stronger ending. Right. So,
and again, for me personally, that's the writing is where that falls down a little bit.
Yeah.
I think that this performance again was I liked.
Yeah, no, I really liked your performance as well, but this is a review of the monologue choice.
Right, exactly. I just want to make sure, just in case Erin happens to watch the video.
Yeah, and she goes that faster.
The ending was a writing thing. Great, so next we have Christopher.
I just want to point out for, because there's no end to me wanting to toot my own horn. It started off for that, and I managed to get it perfectly on by the end of it, just by pausing and unpausing until it was just
beautiful.
Just beautiful. Like, who needs synced audio?
Neat.
Who needs synced audio?
Neat.
Hi, my name is Christopher Puckett, and I'll be doing Sir Patrick from The Doctor's Dilemma, and singing How It Ends from Big Fish. Now, he's a clever operator, is Walpole. Though, he's one of your chloroform surgeons. In my early days, you got your man drowned, and the porters and students held him down, and you had to set your teeth and finish the job fast. Nowadays, you work at your ease. The pain doesn't come until afterward, when you've taken your check, rolled up your bag, and left the house. I tell you, Collie, chloroform has done a lot of mischief. It let every fool become a surgeon. I know your Cutler Walpoles and their like. They've found out. A man's body is full of bits and scraps of old organs that he has no mortal use of. Now, thanks to chloroform, you can cut out half a dozen of them without him being any the worse. Except the illness and the guineas that it costs him. Now, I knew the Walpoles 15 years ago. The father used to snip off the ends of people's uvulas for 50 guineas and paint throats with caustic every day for a year at 2 guineas at a time. His brother-in-law extirpated tonsils for 200 guineas until he took women's cases for double the fees, and Cutler himself worked hard at anatomy to find something fresh to operate on. At last, he got hold of something he calls the Neusiform Sack. Now, he's made it quite the fashion. People pay him 500 guineas to take it out. Well, look at their haircut for all the difference it makes. Suppose it makes them feel important? After it? You can't go out to dinner now without your neighbor bragging to you about some useless operation or other.
Okay. Alrighty. So, first thing on this one, this was a memory monologue.
Mm-hmm.
It was not active.
You know, I was going to say, this was, as a monologue goes, I was really compelled to watch because of the character that was done, but I didn't really understand what was going on all the way through. Like, I get it. He's complaining about a new style of surgery and new surgeries and that kind of stuff, but I'm like, I don't know, why do I, like, what's the greater context I didn't have from the monologue? But I was enthralled the whole time because I was like, I was just into the character. It's like, yeah, this is a grumpy surgeon, right? Like, so let's say when we're evaluating this monologue as a choice for ourselves, it's like, yeah, you're going to knock the character out of the park, right? But we're not really understand, like, the context isn't all the way there.
The text is a vehicle for the character.
Yeah, the text is a vehicle for the character, and the character was delivered really well. There was a couple, and this was essentially, these were all acting choices that really, really did worked well through this monologue. But the monologue itself has lesser stakes. I just was like, yeah, I really like this. I'll watch this grumpy surgeon complain about anything for an hour. Right? And
that's all House was. Right?
Yeah, exactly. Years, right. We watched the same House episode for five seasons. Right. It's like grumpy surgeon figures out something weird is wrong halfway through the thing. Every episode, nothing changed.
Right.
And that's what we see here is really strong character. Right. And so, which I think did this monologue well, right? Because of that. I think if I didn't care about the character because of acting choices and whatever they happened to make, I would put this monologue way further down because of that. But because the vehicle for the character worked so well, right, I was compelled to watch.
Right, and so Christopher, so kind of like we talked about with Erin's monologue,
yeah.
She solved for the ending, the writing not being that strong. Christopher solved this, again, the writing was not strong as far as a character journey.
Yeah.
But he took it for what it was,
mm-hmm.
what the strengths were, and then he ran with it. For me, I would love to see the first 20 seconds cut off of it.
Because
I started getting interested when he said, cuts the tips off of people's uvula for,
yeah.
right? Then, because again, that was strong.
Yeah.
Before that, it was kind of like, I was kind of at sea a little bit. I didn't know what was going on, like you said.
Yeah.
Suddenly, I was going, oh, he's complaining about procedures. He's complaining about beliefs and things like
yeah.
that in his profession.
Yeah.
I think that it was also a really great choice because he said that this was about, he was auditioning for a period piece
yeah.
for a medical profession.
And that's,
so, how on the nose?
Yeah, I was going to say, that is a huge factor in the things. He's doing a period piece. It's
he knew exactly
yeah,
the role he was going
for. He was knowing exactly the role. And so, you know, the fact that he doesn't have this, it's not the perfect, you know, beginning, middle, end, action, middle piece monologue, is muted because there's other things that he's getting value from. He's getting value from being on period. He's getting value from that kind of stuff. And there are some little pieces, and I don't know because I haven't read this script and have it memorized, that I don't know are written into the script, but he would say something and then like say another line offhandedly. And I don't know if that's just written into the script or if he added that in himself, but those kind of things salvaged the character. Right, where he's waxing about something, and then he goes, and then something else, and then goes back, and this is an acting choice, but he's broken up those thoughts into two different pieces, and because he's done that, that was way more compelling than just to deliver the line straight. Right. And so
it was all about character.
Right, and so if that was in the script, right, that would be value for the script. I can't tell you if that's a script or an acting choice.
Right.
That kind of thing added value to that monologue.
Right. Yeah. Great.
And, you know, I guess we already talked about pros and cons of that one. We didn't just glorify or that one. We don't probably have to specifically find
the
a con.
The one other thing that I would say, a potential con, and this goes a little bit more into how do you do your performance. Generally, avoid doing an accent. Unless you are 100% sure that you're going to nail that accent, it's one extra piece that could go wrong. It's one extra piece that could, as you said, could give you a low score.
Yeah.
On something that doesn't need to be scored.
Exactly.
In an audition. Unless you specifically stated in your audition announcement,
show
up with your best British accent. Don't do it in an accent.
Yeah. If you bring something extra to an audition that you don't nail, right, it counts against you.
You only hurt yourself.
Yeah. If you bring something extra to an audition that you knock out of the park, right, you'll add value. But you only have those two options. Do it perfectly and add value, or do it anywhere below 90% and you've detracted from your audition.
Yeah. So weigh those choices really carefully.
Yes. That's, so anytime you're like, you should avoid this, it's like, avoid this unless you do it perfectly, right?
Unless this is your strength.
Yeah, unless this is the thing that you do well.
Right.
And then it becomes a value, and which is a part of why there's not a series of rules for choosing a monologue. It's like, never choose an accent, never juggle, never that kind of thing. You can't just have those rules because I think I've said previously, the target is moving and changes.
Yep, and there's so many variables.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's move on to the next video, which will be Candra.
Candra. Is she a good artist?
She is. Yeah.
She can draw.
I'm going to restart the video.
Oh, yeah, I didn't start.
That joke was not worth it. Shame on you. Okay, you ready?
Yeah.
All right, here goes. Okay, you ready?
Yeah.
All right, here goes.
Yeah, I get a little depressed sometimes. I don't know, maybe because I feel cut off from my body a little bit. Maybe it's because I have so many clothes. I have so many clothes. Makes me feel like a Barbie doll. And I think sometimes I do too much shopping, you know? Shop and it makes me feel great that I can do that. I feel strong. It almost gets me high. But then sooner or later I like collapse. And I feel so bad. Ashamed. Like I've sinned. And like, nothing. Like I was nothing. And then I'm in bed, and if you're out there working somewhere, working at a big, fat job, and I just feel so weak from that idea that I can't get up. I have to call somebody on the phone. I have to call everybody I've ever known on the phone from my bed. Like I was a little spider weaving a web out of telephone wire. Just to stand up and walk.
Fade transition there at the end.
Yeah.
Oh, that helped.
Yeah.
The first impressions. You have to do your first impressions first this time.
Okay. My first impression, I was drawn in immediately because the text says, sometimes I get so depressed. Mm-hmm. And she had such a fantastic smile while she delivered it. Mm-hmm. So the juxtaposition between what she was saying and what she was showing and the conviction that she started with.
Yeah.
I was brought in right away.
Yeah, I was going to say the same thing, is that it was very well acted. That the opening was really strong because there's just a lot of emotions in the beginning that like you could just are coming through very, very clearly. And really on type. This is a little, you know, I don't know if it's too stereotypical to say, but you know, we've got this woman shopping, you know, like, and that's that it's just believable, right? Obviously, you know, you've got men and women who both are like that. But it's not jarring at all to have there's no contradiction there. And so
plus I think her look, she's presented in a very attractive way. Mm-hmm. She talks about like being like a Barbie.
Yes.
So yeah,
she talks
about
her clothes, all that kind of stuff.
I didn't doubt her.
Yeah, I think there's a little bit of context missing from here that, like, I found myself confused once or twice. It resolves quickly, but I step out of the monologue at one point when she's like, I just have to call everybody, and I feel like I'm a spider, and then there's a big break. It's weaving a web of telephone wires. I go, why is she a spider? For a moment, and... while the illusion is clever, a spider of telephone wires is like poetry as far as...
even almost rhymes.
Yeah. The break in the center there just allowed for a little bit of confusion, right? And that the line, we travel from like, I'm sad and I have a shopping addiction to we're going somewhere else. And there's that transition inside the monologue is confusing. I think we get to a place where it kind of makes sense altogether, but there was a moment there where I was a little lost, and that can be valued or kind of against the choice of that monologue.
Yeah, absolutely. We've talked before about you don't want the director to get pulled out of the moment.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So what I might suggest with this monologue, if I were talking to her, is consider cutting that out.
Mm-hmm.
Just cut that one or two sentences out.
Yeah.
I don't think, again, this is my one viewing, so I don't know for sure, but I don't think that it would lose what was going on if you took that phrase out, if you took that metaphor.
Yeah.
I think that it would have been better if there was something about spiders or insects or bugs or something at another place in the monologue, so it was a metaphor that ran through the whole text.
Because that metaphor, well, it's, you know, it's cool, like I was saying. I just, like, I don't get why it's being used, right?
It feels out of place.
It feels out of place.
It's a very, like, tangible, earthbound monologue. She's going through very grounding emotions.
Mm-hmm.
Suddenly becomes poetry.
Yeah.
And then it goes back to being grounded again.
Yeah. And so, and that section of like having to call everybody to get out of bed, I think you can infer the context for it, right? Mm-hmm. But it's still, I don't think we're necessarily there by the end of the monologue, right? So it's like the wording, the monologue as written starts really strong and then gets to a place where it kind of reaches confusion. One of the things that I think she did really, really well was have this emotional throughput of a thing, which made it so that I was compelled to watch the whole thing anyway. I wasn't like, okay, next, you know.
Again, talking about the performance over the... So again, the choice. I think that Candra took a good monologue.
Yeah.
And she found just to touch on her performance for me, she found the subtext. And she played the subtext. I loved almost all of her uses of pausing and what she did with the tempo. Almost 100% through.
Yeah.
There's a couple points where I think it was a little much. Didn't quite hit the mark, but again, that's her performance.
Yeah.
I think the monologue itself, I think one of the follies of when you're choosing a monologue, you want to know who your other is, who it is you're talking to.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I get the feeling that she's talking to a psychiatrist kind of thing, which is low-hanging fruit for your monologue. So again, try to find a monologue that's more compelling, because while this could be considered an active monologue because she's going through these emotions right now, if she's talking to her psychiatrist, she's probably sitting on a couch or laying on a bed or something while she's doing it. So it's an inactive monologue.
Yeah. You could see, like, if this was staged and she's talking to the person that she's feeling distant from, you know, like who this other person that's going out and working is, it's a lot more active. It's a longing, you know.
Right.
If she's just reminiscing to somebody else, she's complaining to somebody else, then it loses a little bit of its punch, right?
Yeah.
I think it's really well acted, right? Mm-hmm. And so then that becomes really compelling when something's really well acted, which is something to consider when choosing a monologue, is that, like, it's like, you know what? I can nail the this thing out of this, right? Mm-hmm. Remove that in post. I can nail the ship out of this. And I think in this case, especially the beginning, I was like really drawn in. And so that kind of thing, it needs to be considered as well.
Yeah. I think another downfall of the writing of this monologue is I feel like the climax hits about 2/3 of the way through the monologue.
Mm-hmm.
And then she had kind of said everything that I needed to hear at that point. And the stuff that came after that, it was almost like, in my mind, I was going, I get it.
Yeah.
Right? You've told me. So as opposed to Aaron's monologue, where the throughput continued to push all the way to the end, with this monologue, it landed beautifully about 2/3 of the way through, and then I was bored.
Yeah.
There was nothing new to bring to it. And maybe that's why the little piece of poetry was in there. Maybe the playwright realized.
Yeah.
But just kind of recognize where's the climax of your monologue, and is there a way that you can adjust that?
Mm-hmm.
Can you move it somehow?
Yeah. And that's something also that, like, you may not realize when this monologue is taken from the context of the play, right? Mm-hmm. It's like, we might have already had, like, this character does use this kind of illusion often, and this thing is very natural for them to, the way they talk.
Right.
And so evaluating the context on its own might serve this monologue a little better. One of the other things, we didn't get a playwright, we didn't get a play that it's from, or we didn't get any context of why she this
play
was chosen.
She put it in the original monologue. It's from a play called Women of Manhattan.
Okay.
Which I'm not familiar with.
Me.
But yeah, that was she didn't have it in the slate. And I think that's because, I think that was just the way she had submitted this before, was it was two monologues in a video.
Yeah.
So I think this was the second monologue in the...
Gotcha.
In her. Okay, we've got one more to take a look at.
Yep.
So
Erin with an A.
Erin with two A's.
Two
actually.
A's.
This is Erin.
Erin.
All right. So let's see what Erin has for us. Erin has for us.
This is from The Merchant of Venice by William Shakespeare. This is a monologue I would primarily use for dramatic auditions. Signor Antonio, many a time and oft in the Rialto you have rated me about my monies and my usances. Still, have I borne it with a patient shrug, for sufferance is the badge of all our tribe. You call me misbeliever, cutthroat dog, and spet upon my Jewish gabardine, and all for use of that which is mine own. Well, it now appears you need my help. What should I say to you? Should I not say, hath a dog money? Is it possible a cur could lend 3,000 ducats? Or shall I bend low, and in a bondsman's key, with bated breath and whispering humbleness, say this? Oh, fair sir, you spat on me on Wednesday last, you spurned me such a day, another time you called me dog, and for these courtesies, I'll lend thee thus much monies.
Okay. Merchant of Venice. So,
yeah. But, I liked the character presented. So we go into this monologue. It's got these flowery things. I guess I should say I like the choice. The context of this thing is immediately apparent from the words of the monologue, right? Mm-hmm. It's like, look, you come to me, you know, like
you come to me.
Yeah, it's like, how ironic is it that you who have made fun of me are coming to me for money? Right? And he's bathing in the irony of it, right? I don't need to know anything, but you don't need to watch watch the Shakespeare play, this Shakespeare of the Shakespeare's, this one, The Merchant of Venice, to know what this is. Even though the language is flowery, you could be a seventh grader and understand it because he's understood the material really well, which mm-hmm. is,
yep, you could tell he knew what he was saying.
Yes, yep. Right? And which is often a problem when you get a Shakespeare monologue. It's like, well, it's Shakespeare, so it's good. And then it's not good because you didn't bring it, right? This in this case, we did, right?
Which is, you know, I want to point out there's a lot of actors that shy away from Shakespeare.
Yeah.
But there's a reason why he's endured for 500 years.
Yeah.
It's because the quality of the language, it gives you everything. Mm-hmm. So you have the context, you have the setting, you know the players that are involved, you know what's going on just from the words.
Yeah.
Everything is there that you need as an actor in order to take advantage of the storytelling.
Mm-hmm.
So trust it. If you have a need for a classic monologue,
yeah.
Don't, I call it Shakespeare, don't be afraid to get into his works. Because it's going to pay off if you understand what you're saying.
Yes. And in this case, we see that. And one of the things I liked about this play is we follow a trajectory and we land at what is essentially a cliffhanger, right? Mm-hmm. I'm upset that they only watched 2 minutes of this. It's like, I now need to finish this
play. Right, I want more.
You know?
Yeah.
And so that's a good landing place is also at... the handshake here moment is like, oh, what happens next? What did the other person say? You know, like, I need to know how it continues.
And a strong ending for your monologue, he chose an acting strong ending.
Yes.
By spitting in his hand and holding it out.
Yeah.
That is an audition you will remember.
Yes.
So again, it's not so much in the monologue selection, but he chose a piece that offered something like that.
It
offered a really strong choice at the end.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I also like that he didn't choose the well-known monologue.
Yes.
From Merchant of Venice. Mm-hmm. If you cut me, do we not bleed, right?
Yeah.
He took the same character from a little bit earlier
mm-hmm.
and delved into it. But
yeah.
It's smart because it's a character that theater people, even if you haven't read Merchant of Venice, were familiar with who Shylock is.
Mm-hmm.
So we have some context. You've been talking about that before with some of these other monologues, not having context. So we have context right away because of who the character is.
Yeah.
So we can understand, and it's very easy for our brains to kind of fill in some of the other information.
Yeah.
Super easy for that to happen.
Yeah, and that's one of those where I think the inference is actually helping the monologue selection because it's so very clear. It's painting with a negative, right? He's saying like, you know, you who comes to, like, you don't even need to know who the you is in this, right? To know what the you has done to Shylock, right? Which is a really good choice for that. And like you're saying, it's not the monologue that you're used to seeing from it, but still perfectly encapsulates the character. You get this sense, like, if he was auditioning for any sort of, like, rogue, right, any Han Solo type bravado character, he's got the part because he brought that to the...
Or even with a little twisted delivery, a villain character.
Yes, exactly.
Because that's when Shylock, written, of course, was a villain. Now yes. We see him in a different light nowadays. Mm-hmm. But which brings up my downside with this,
yeah,
which is the ethnicity.
Mm-hmm.
To have Shylock, when we're talking about things like Jewish character, there's a little bit more give and take in mm-hmm. that because being Jewish is an ethnicity, but it's also a religion.
Yeah.
And so you can play this character off. There's a little bit of freedom with Jewish characters. Same thing if you're playing, if you're a white guy and you're playing an Irish character or German character, right? So when we're talking about ethnicities, there is still a little room there. But I would, I'm not going to say this was a poor choice, but I would question a blonde-haired, blue-eyed white guy playing, choosing a monologue by Shylock.
Yeah.
This is one of those instances. I don't know
mm-hmm.
whether it's an inappropriate choice or not, but it's something that I would question.
Yeah, it is something to consider in your choice.
Yeah,
right?
When you select your monologues.
It's something to be aware of because... you know, and if you're ever like confused on an angle, go talk to other people, right? The more voices you get, the more you'll get a sense of the culture about it, right?
The appropriateness. Or just don't do it.
Yeah.
If you're not sure,
find
a different model.
That is a very safe piece of advice. If you're not sure, do something else.
Yeah.
And it will be, you'll be way safer doing that.
Great. Yeah. So, so that's
the point.
Finding a monologue. So to review, a couple things to think about finding a monologue. First of all, read plays. Read lots and lots and lots of plays. A play is usually an hour and a half to 2 hours. I read an article recently where a theater scholar was saying that actors should be reading a minimum of 8 plays every week, which is not that much, really. It's 2 hours a day to read 7 of your plays. I would say if you can read at least 1 new play a week.
Yeah.
Something so that you get better at reading plays, you get better at cold reading, you get better at understanding characters and plot devices, and you'll start to recognize tropes and all of those things that are just going to help you.
Mm-hmm.
So I would urge you to set a goal of at least 1 play a week.
Yeah.
That you read.
If you don't have the time for that kind of thing, or you're way more casual about it, if you could just always be reading a play, right? Like mm-hmm. you just have a play that you are reading, you read it when you have time to read it, is going to help you because you're always in the mode, right? If you are, obviously, if you're trying to be a working actor that's constantly working, you should be reading plays as much as you have time to. But if it's a more casual experience for you, but you could still just have a play that you're reading and then read it as you have time. Because the easiest way to improve, right, the most straightforward path is to read more plays.
Right, so you understand the language.
Mm-hmm.
You want to think about your type. Get input if you're not sure what your type is. Find a monologue that you enjoy performing,
mm-hmm.
and that you feel a connection with, and that's going to show off the best version of you.
Yeah.
Look for a monologue that's appropriate for the role, for the company. Make sure that you're not pushing the envelope too far in your audition piece.
Mm-hmm.
Look for an active monologue, not one where you're sitting on the psychiatrist's couch.
Yeah.
Reminiscing about the good old days. There's so many great monologues that are reminiscing monologues, but they're not compelling in an audition.
Yeah, as a standalone piece.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I'd say to summarize all of the different advices here, the idea is the audition is you trying to present your best self. And so you need to find a monologue that is a good platform to do that on, right? Because mm-hmm. It is the base of your audition. The acting choices, all those kind of things stand on top of the monologue, right? So you want to identify your best self, what you do the greatest, and find a monologue that fits that, right? And you can present your best self and, you know, all of the different factors that we discussed that goes into that. And so, from there, read plays so you can find the monologue that is that, right? That's how it ties all in together.
That's how it ties all in together. So thanks for joining us.
Yep.
For watching.
Tuning in to the short or long version.
Yeah, the short or long version.
Whatever you happen to be watching.
Joren, thank you.
Thanks, Scott.
Yep. And let's do this again soon.
Oh, real soon.
All right. Thank you.